Welcome, everybody, to Life Sciences Phase 2. I'm not supposed to be... I did something wrong earlier, which is I didn't wave, and I'm now waving. Maybe it's, again, too late. But I'm taking 60 seconds in advance of the time they were supposed to start in order to start, because I just can't stand sitting there anymore waiting to introduce Gary Ruvkun and the other three speakers. So the session this afternoon is on genetic origin and manipulation of disease. And I'm very happy to be standing in for Peter Walter, who I always wanted to be, but I couldn't, just a birth accident. You're going to hear about a very wide span of different kinds of study, from microRNA to funny things from bugs that may transform everything that we do in everybody, to how you can cure angiogenesis and manipulate it and how it functions, to oncogenes. And the speakers are going to be Gary Ruvkun, Jennifer Doudna, Napoleone Ferrara, and Bob Weinberg. And so the first talk is by Gary Ruvkun, and the title is The Tiny RNA World. Gary.
Thanks very much. It's good to be back at Berkeley. This is where I was an undergrad. And so this is where I came of age. And so any immaturity you see is the fault of this university. And let me start with a description of this organism, C. elegans, that many of us work on. There's a few thousand people in the world who do research on this. And it attracted a great cohort of people from about the early 70s through to today. And one of the reasons I think it attracted really great people to work on it was the description of development of this animal was more digital seeming than the description of development that you learn about in developmental biology textbooks, which is, you know, sort of this is muscle and it gets induced when it gets next to epidermal cells, that sort of thing. And this was a description of a lineage of divisions starting from a single cell, it would divide once. This is embryogenesis, sort of 12 hours. And then some of these cells are blast cells that would go on to divide, generating an adult animal over the next 3 days. And that rather digital description of developmental decisions made many of us think that it would sort of be almost like a computational program on how development would be programmed, and that we could do the genetics of that by sort of changing the steps of this program. And I think it attracted faux mathematicians to developmental biology, and I count myself as a faux mathematician. And many of the people thought in those terms. And so the way we wanted to address this was by doing genetic analysis of this worm and getting mutants that would do development improperly. And this whole enterprise of developmental genetics was, jumping into the deep end of a pool of a very rich intellectual tradition that evolved early in my career of superb fly geneticists and yeast geneticists and worm geneticists meeting with each other and perturbing developmental systems in really interesting ways. And it was a fantastic cauldron of discovery that took place in the early 80s for about 20-year period. And the developmental biology Gordon conferences and things like that were an amazing education. And our part in that, in the worm community, one aspect of it was these heterochronic mutants, which were mutants isolated by Victor Ambrose and Bob Horvitz, that cause cell lineage changes. If you watch the division, this is looking at a larval stage one animal, and these are the blast cells along the skin of the animal that will go on to divide as time progresses. And in a wild type animal, they'll do this pattern of divisions at larval stage one, two, three, four, adult. And in these LIN14 or LIN4 mutants, we could see that the lineage was changed. So for example, what would normally take place in an L2 stage would move one stage earlier in a LIN14 null, or this pattern of divisions that would normally take place only in the L1 stage could get reiterated at multiple stages if you were either missing LIN4 or had an opposite kind of allele of LIN14 that was an activating mutation. And so from this pattern of changes in cell lineage, and again, this is using the lineage as a kind of a phenotype, using the fact that you can describe development in that kind of precise detail, this opposite of gain-of-function mutants having the opposite phenotype of loss-of-function and having a loss-of-function that mimicked a gain-of-function made us confident that we had our hands on some of the developmental switches that take place to control this one aspect of lineage. Now, this is not to say we're talking about the entire lineage, right? We're talking about very particular subparts of this lineage. But again, it's a computer programmer kind of view that if you want understand one subroutine, it might inform the larger set of subroutines. And so what are the molecular flesh of this genetic construct, right? This is all pure genetics. We learn about these things from getting mutants. They get named as genes by mapping them onto chromosomes and doing complementation tests. It's old style Mendelian genetics where you say this is a lesion that changes something. I wonder what it might encode. And so to figure that out, we had to do the mapping of where these genes were and sort of precisely figure out the molecular details. And here we were really lucky that John Sulston, the same heroic figure that did this lineage, got interested in genomics just in time for the rest of us to not have to do genomics. And so he started putting together maps of yeast artificial chromosomes and cosmids and big chunks of DNA so that we had a physical map of the worm genome and we could hone in on what the gene was. And by sort of doing rather classical genetic mapping with restriction fragment length polymorphisms, we could hone in on what the gene was. And the first hint of what we were working on was that in the LIN14 gene, these gain-of-function mutations, the activating mutations that made the gene more active than a wild-type gene, were deletions in the 3' untranslated region or a translocation that would completely lop off that 3' untranslated region. So that said, there's some kind of off switch or vernier dial that's turning down the juice on this gene, and if you miss that, the gene becomes hyperactive. The second hint in what was going on was from Victor Ambrose's lab, where Candy Lee and Rosalind Feinbaum figured out that the LIN4 gene encodes a very tiny RNA. So this is showing that the RNA in the gray box is the mature 22 nucleotide RNA, and this is the precursor of that RNA. And this RNA builds up over time, and that acts as a switch gene. And what Victor and I figured out was that if you take the sequence of the LIN4 RNA, shown on this bottom strand here, and try to match it up with the LIN14, 3' untranslated region, you could see these multiple regions where the LIN4 RNA on the bottom could base pair rather imperfectly, as you can see, to, for example, region 1, or this is showing region 2, or this is showing region 3. There were 7 sites in the 3' untranslated region, and these sites were deleted, many of them, in a weak gain-of-function allele, or completely gone in a stronger gain-of-function allele. In addition, these regions where we could see the base pairing, as well as other regions that we still cannot explain, we could see conservation. So the gray bars show areas where when you compared this genome sequence to the genome sequence of other nematodes, you could see that these RNA segments were under some kind of selective constraint over evolutionary time that would correspond to something like 50 million years. And making an antibody to the LIN14 protein we could see that the protein product of this gene is expressed at a high level at the early stage, and that specifies that pattern of division that we see at the L1 stage. And then it would go to a much lower level at the next stage. In a gain-of-function mutant, that switching off would not occur. Now, when we look at a heterozygote between this gain-of-function mutant and wild type, so this is a deletion over plus, what we can see on a northern blot, these are different size messages because one has a 600 base deletion, is they have the same abundance at the larval stage 1, and they also have a very similar abundance at larval stage 4. So it's not the mRNA that's getting decreased, it's the translation of that mRNA. And so the microRNA is affecting translation. So what this showed was that these microRNAs can regulate the production of a protein product without causing RNA degradation. And that was the mechanism by which this microRNA regulates its target. The second sort of jump in the tiny RNA or microRNA rebellion was doing the genetics of this system. So LIN4, we knew, was a negative regulator of LIN14. And we could take a LIN14 allele and ask for genetically what are the mutants that could suppress that to get at the other players in the pathway. And out of that came a gene called LET7, which had already been identified in a null allele as a lethal. LET stands for lethal. And that strain died of a lethal bursting from its sexual apparatus. It would sort of blow out from there. But we could figure out are there suppressors of that, and out of that came LIN41. So we could suppress the lethality of LET7 and get mutations in LIN41. And when we pulled out LET7, it turned out to be another microRNA, completely non-homologous to the first one. And this is the sequence of it, and this is the mutation that was the temperature-sensitive allele of LET7. And it's also temporally regulated, so this LET7 microRNA is not on early in development. It comes on at a later period, specifying a transition during development, again, in time. Now, in the LET7 case, when we took the sequence of LET7 and just did a simple blast analysis to other organisms, we could see that this was perfectly conserved across evolution. And I'm ashamed to say that this, we figured this out when I was writing a grant. And I was saying in the grant, I'm at home, and I'm saying, we're gonna look for a human homolog of LET7. And this is in the days of modems. And I said, I'll do a blast. So I paste it into a blast server, and 10 seconds later, this comes out. So that was incredibly easy to do, right? And this is the key of genomics, I think, in the modern age, is that to actually look for LET7 homologs by making it radioactive and screening libraries, I would have never had the oomph to do that. But to just paste it into a blast server, no problemo. And so that said that this is a conserved, and that microRNAs are not just in the province of these little worms. And this is kind of important because I showed you that lineage, which is a weird wormism, right? The fact that worms use lineage to control development is not something that applies to everything else. And so in the developmental biology community, worms were always considered slightly an outlier, and these guys they chirp in their own little language about lineage. Now in the RNA world, the people who think about ribosomal RNAs and messenger RNAs and splicing, those characters were, first of all, they don't know any biology, so they were perfectly happy to say, what you're finding in C. elegans must be universal because everything's universal. And so we were not sort of an outsider group. So this was important to us in the developmental biology community to say something that does timing control and development might be universal. And it regulates its target genes by base pairing to this LIN41, very much in the same way. Again, not perfect base pairing, and that imperfect base pairing really mediates the translational control as opposed to RNA degradation. Now, moving into the more recent era with genomics and deep sequencing of tiny RNAs, we now know that how many microRNAs there are in various organisms, and there's thousands, about a third of which are conserved very, very broadly. The animal clade of organisms has a very common set of microRNAs. Plants have their own set of microRNAs that are not ancestrally related in the sense that the common ancestor of animals and plants probably didn't have a microRNA per se. It probably had siRNAs. Now, one last thing I wanted to mention is, okay, the microRNAs are sort of the first example of a tiny RNA, and then what followed was the discovery of RNAi by Fire and Mello and the discovery of siRNAs that are produced from RNAi by David Balcom. And those siRNAs were also 22 nucleotides long. And what was interesting to me was that 22 is actually a holy number in the Jewish Kabbalah. And I would bring people into my office. This is, again, my Berkeley background coming back. With astrology, you know, numerology. And you could go to websites that would have New Age music that goes with these Kabbalistic trees. That wasn't very helpful in figuring out how this works. What was helpful was that the first enzymes that were involved with RNA are the dicer RNAs that cleaves the long double-stranded RNAs into 22 nucleotides, that had been discovered. And the first RNAi defective mutants with their PIWIPAS proteins, a particular kind of protein that binds to 22 nucleotides, had been discovered. And we tested whether members of these gene families were involved in how LET7 might work. And so we could feed the worm, and this is one of the magic things about RNAi, is that you can actually inactivate genes by feeding. So we could give the worm double-stranded RNA corresponding to all the members of these families and ask, what does it do to the LIN4 or the LET7 RNA? And this is the mature RNA, and these are the unprocessed RNAs when you are missing these PIWIPAS proteins or dicer. And so that showed that these two pathways use the same mechanism for making these 22 nucleotide RNAs. So doing a large-scale screen for components of RNAi, we could use RNAi to go through, and I just wanted to mention that we get a lot of candidates out of these screens, so we can ask for, by feeding RNAi, who give phenotypes that look a lot like the LET7 phenotype, the bursting from the abdomen, and then we can do secondary screens whether they have defects in developmental timing. And this, what this does is generate a lot of ideas, and I just wanted to put up a Linus Pauling quote, which I really love, is, you know, good ideas don't come by just having, one or two. You really have to have a lot of ideas, and many of your ideas should be bad, according to this, right? It's not that all your ideas are going to be good. So when we do these RNAi screens, we have a lot of ideas that come out of them. And here's one that might be good or it might be bad. And that is one of the hits out of this screen is the mevalonate pathway. So these are a gene inactivation that's a lot like taking a statin drug. And if you give worms statin drugs, they have the same defect as we do with microRNAs. And it really suggests the idea that one of the molecular pathways by which statins might work to be therapeutic for coronary artery disease, for example, is regulating microRNAs. And consistent with that as an idea is that there are knockouts that Eric Olson has made of microRNAs called miR-206 in a mouse that really makes them resistant to fibrosis of the heart, where a normal mouse, for example, would have that. So that's what we've been doing. Happy to take any questions.
So a couple of questions for Gary before we move on to Jennifer.
The talk was about microRNAs and...
Thank you, Gary.
All right.
Barbara.
How many microRNAs do you attribute to human disease?
Uh-huh. Well, I don't know the exact number, but there's a couple that have been implicated in some blood cancers that in a deletion of those microRNAs, some growth control protein targets go out of control, and it's known who the microRNA targets are. I think that's the best example of human disease. It's lymphoma. Oh, okay, good, thanks. All right.
Okay, thank you, Gary. Right. Thank you.
Okay. The next talk is by Jennifer Doudna from Berkeley, and the title is The CRISPR-Cas9 Genome Engineering Revolution. Jennifer.
Hello, everyone. Is this on? Yeah. Hi, everyone. So what I want to do is tell you about a technology that grew out of a curiosity-driven research project in my lab here at Berkeley. And I'm going to start by just posing the question, suppose we had a way to go into cells and make a very precise change to the DNA of the cell, so precise that we could change a single base pair in the entire human genome, for example, much like we might fix a typo in a Word document. Sounds like science fiction, but this is actually a technology that is now in our hands. And it really came about through not a focused effort to discover such a technology, but actually through a curiosity-driven research project that was aimed at figuring out how bacteria fight the flu, fight viral infection. And for me, this project really started with a great conversation that I had with a colleague here at Berkeley, Jillian Banfield, who is in the College of Natural Resources at Berkeley. And Jill does a lot of work with bacteria. She likes to focus on bacteria that have never been isolated, never been cultured in the laboratory. She's trying to understand what's out there in terms of the microbial world. And in the course of her research, she came across a very interesting observation, which was namely that a lot of bacteria have a very unusual sequence signature present somewhere in the DNA genome of the cell that looks like this, where you have a series of repeated DNA sequences, about 40 base pairs in length, and in between those repeats are unique sequences of also about 40 base pairs in length. And people since 1987 had occasionally noticed these in their data, and these had come to be called CRISPRs, which stands for clusters of regularly interspaced short palindromic repeats, a big mouthful. We like to use CRISPR. And it refers to this pattern of DNA sequences that can occur in bacterial genomes. And the reason that Jill called me about this was that we were working away in my lab here at Berkeley on ways that small RNA molecules can control the expression of genes, much as what you just heard about in Gary Ruvkun's talk. And we were trying to understand the molecular mechanisms that underlie those pathways. And Jill wondered whether there might actually be a role for RNA molecules in a pathway that might stem from the presence of these sequences, because in 2005, three labs had pointed out that when they looked at these CRISPR loci, they found that these unique sequences in between the repeats very often corresponded exactly to sequences that could be found in the viruses that infect these bacteria. And so together with that observation and the fact that next door to these sequences are typically a set of CRISPR-associated or Cas genes that co-vary with the sequences over here, the idea was maybe this is some way that bacteria record over time the infections that they've experienced from viruses, keep a little genetic record in the context of this kind of a sequence pattern, and then somehow use that sequence information to protect the cells. And Jill thought, wouldn't it be amazing if that was happening through production of RNA molecules, little copies of these sequences that might be made and used by these cells? And she knew we were working on RNA, so she wondered if we would like to test that idea. And so what emerged over the next several years, one of the interesting twists to this story is that the first genetic data experiments that test this idea of a bacterial immune system came from work done at a yogurt company, Danisco, by Rodolphe Berengo and Philippe Horvath, was to show that, in fact, bacteria that have a CRISPR locus can defend themselves. They can acquire immunity to phage, bacteriophage, that infect the cell by detecting that foreign DNA as it gets injected, here shown by a virus, injecting this into a cell. Little bits of that foreign DNA are integrated into the CRISPR locus in such a way that they are stored there permanently. They can be passed on to the next generation of bacteria. And then those DNA sequences are copied into RNA and form the basis for targeted recognition of sequences that have the same, have a matching sequence to what was recorded originally. And those, so these RNA molecules are broken up into bits that each include one sequence derived from a virus. They assemble with proteins, one or more proteins encoded by the Cas genes, to form RNA protein targeting complexes that use the sequence information in the RNA to base pair with foreign DNA and allow these proteins to cut up the viral DNA. So this seemed like a very interesting parallel, actually, to RNA interference and the way that microRNAs work, as Gary described in the previous talk. And so we thought it would be really interesting to figure out how bacteria actually do this. What's the mechanism for this kind of a defense pathway? And so in my lab, we started working on this central part of the pathway, namely how these RNA molecules are created in the cell, how they assemble with proteins, and how they carry out this targeting mechanism. And what emerged from that was a series of mechanistic insights that led us to eventually partner with a colleague of mine, Emmanuel Charpentier, who was at the time located in Sweden, a medical microbiologist. And we decided to work together to understand the molecular function of a particular Cas protein called Cas9 that is the only gene necessary in some bacteria for this viral defense pathway to function. And what emerged from that collaboration was that Cas9 is a very interesting protein that is essentially programmable, can be programmed with these bits of CRISPR-derived RNA molecules. And so by doing experiments with purified proteins and RNAs in our laboratories, we figured out that Cas9 has the ability to recognize double-stranded DNA at sequences that match a 20-nucleotide sequence present in the CRISPR RNA, which is this molecule that's shown right here in this cartoon. And at those sequences, the Cas9 protein opens up the DNA double helix, positioning two active sites in the protein to generate a double-stranded break in the DNA. Now, there were a couple of interesting twists to the way this works. We found out, first of all, that this targeting has to occur adjacent to a little motif called the PAM sequence in the DNA. So for this particular Cas9 protein, that's a GG dinucleotide motif in the DNA, or two GC base pairs next to each other. And the other thing was that this actually, system actually requires a second RNA molecule called tracer, which is this red molecule right here, which can interact by base pairing with the end of the CRISPR RNA. It forms a structure that recruits the Cas9 protein. So you really have to have both of these RNAs and the protein, and then you can get this kind of targeted double-stranded DNA cutting. And so once Martin Jinek in my lab had figured this out, he realized that he could actually, sort of like a good biochemist, he was trimming away at these RNAs, and he realized that he might actually be able to simplify the system relative to what nature has done to create a two-component system, a single RNA that would have the targeting ability and the Cas9 capability in the same molecule. And so he created a chimeric single guide form of the RNA that has the targeting information in the molecule right here, and then it has the Cas9 binding information over here. And so this is an RNA that can be programmed by simply changing this 20 nucleotide sequence to direct it to different sites in a DNA where we as scientists might want to introduce a double-stranded break in DNA and actually have this, protein go to that site and create the double-stranded break. And so just to show you how this actually works, and I'll say a little bit more about this in a couple of minutes, but this is a 3D printed model of the Cas9 protein in white with its guide RNA in orange and a DNA molecule running through the protein. And you can actually see this DNA double helix coming in. As it enters the protein, it actually opens up and allows interaction of this 20 nucleotide stretch of the DNA with the RNA. So you get an RNA-DNA hybrid inside the protein. The other strand of the DNA is peeled away, and this allows the two molecular blades in the protein to actually make a very precise cut in the DNA. Now, so this was sort of the moment for us when this project went from being a kind of a cool, fun project to realizing that we might be sitting on a really exciting technology. And the reason to think that was that in parallel with the very sleepy field of CRISPR biology at that time was a lot of research that had gone on over the past couple of decades showing that in animal and plant cells, there's very sophisticated machinery for detecting double-stranded DNA breaks in those cells and fixing them. And so when cells, if this is genomic piece of segment out of a genome, a genomic DNA, if that DNA is broken at a site, we have a double-stranded break in the DNA, these cells can repair that break through a process called non-homologous end joining that leads to typically a little disruption in the DNA sequence as the ends are pasted back together. Or if there's a donor DNA template in the cell, that molecule can be recombined into the DNA if there's a little bit of overlapping homologous sequence to actually introduce new genetic information at exactly the site where the double-stranded break occurred. And so scientists had appreciated this and had been working away for a while to try to figure out how do we introduce double-stranded breaks exactly where we want to make a change in a genome. And so some technologies for doing this had come along that were actually very promising. And these were are shown here, zinc finger nucleases or TALEN proteins or homing endonucleases are all protein-based technologies that require engineering a new protein that can recognize a particular DNA sequence. And by coupling it to a cleaving domain of a protein, then you can have an engineered enzyme that will actually make a double-stranded break in DNA exactly where you want it. And these can work very well, and you might have seen very recently in the news a story about a 1-year-old child that had leukemia, and they were actually able to use a TALEN-based strategy to create a cancer immunotherapy that was effective in her case. So these therapies, kinds of technologies can be extremely powerful. The challenge was that they're also very labor intensive. A new protein had to be engineered for every experiment. And so it just meant that most scientists around the world had not been able to adopt this technology. It was too expensive, it was too time consuming, and it required too much expertise. We thought, wouldn't it be cool if you could use one protein, never have to change it, and redirect it to create a targeted double-stranded break by simply changing the sequence of a short guide RNA that is quite easy to do by standard molecular biology methods. And so that was exactly what we proposed when we published this work in the summer of 2012, was that this could be a very interesting way to do RNA-programmed genome editing. And so what happened next was quite amazing. And that is that a number of labs around the world saw this paper and started to test it in different systems. And this is a slide I got from my colleague at North Carolina State University, Rodolphe Berengo, and showing just the sort of exponential adoption of the CRISPR technology over the last 3 years as people start using it worldwide for different kinds of applications. And in fact, even before the end of 2012, there were 6 papers submitted for publication from different labs, including our own, showing that you could use this technology for engineering human cells, but also for actually engineering entire organisms like zebrafish. So it's one of the things that's made it so exciting is that it's a platform for doing genome engineering that works essentially in any system where people have tested it. So people have asked me, why did this technology take off in a way that these earlier technologies didn't? And I think there are really sort of 3 answers to that question. One is what I like to call software versus hardware, where the older technologies were protein-based and effectively hardwired. You had to recreate or create a new protein or pair of proteins for every experiment. Here, we have something that is sort of more analogous to software. We can reprogram a single protein easily using a small fragment of RNA. So it just means that it's a technology that is easily adopted and tested in different systems. And because it generally is effective in these cells, people have been able to employ it for all sorts of applications. It works in, as I mentioned, in essentially any animal and plant system that's been tested so far. And as I want to share with you now, we know that this has evolved in bacteria for rapid and accurate DNA recognition, which means that it's really very useful for lots of applications where you need precision in the editing that you want to do. So I'm going to show you, I want to show you a short movie, if you can play the movie. So this is sort of our how we imagine this might operate in a eukaryotic cell. So here we are zooming into the cell, and as we look inside the nucleus, of course, in eukaryotic cells, the DNA is highly packaged in chromatin. So somehow this bacterial enzyme has to deal with DNA that's wound around histones here to form these nucleosome structures. It has to find a single target site, for example, in a genome that has a 20 base pair match to the guide RNA in the protein. And when it does, it opens up the DNA, and the molecular blades in the protein make this double-stranded break. And now we have a break in the DNA that has to be repaired, and the cell has machinery for doing that. In this example here, by introducing or recombining in a segment of DNA that introduces new information into this particular genome. And it does that in a targeted fashion. And so, you know, people are now using this to engineer plants, animals, lots of organisms that in the past were genetically intractable by using this kind of a strategy. So how does it work? And that's something that, you know, my lab is very keen to understand. We feel like, you know, the opportunity to understand this at a molecular level is not only interesting and reveals fundamental biology, but it actually will be very important for ensuring that this technology is really going to be useful for doing things like curing human genetic disease. So one of the things that's been very interesting about this protein Cas9 is that it's easily modified. And you'll hear about this later from Jonathan Weissman. His lab has done a lot of this work. But basically, it's been possible to make this protein into a version that is deactivated for DNA cleavage. It can bind DNA in a targeted way, but not actually generate a double-stranded break. And then that protein can also be coupled to functional domains that allow genes to be turned on or turned off in a very specific fashion. So that's a very powerful application of this that doesn't involve any genome engineering per se. It doesn't involve making double-stranded breaks in the DNA of a genome. And people have also been able to use that kind of approach for imaging, looking at particular sites in a genome by lighting them up using a fluorescently labeled version of this protein. It's naturally multiplexed, and what I mean by that is that in bacteria, bacteria naturally will program this protein with a variety of different guide RNAs because they want to protect the cell from multiple viruses at the same time. That means that as scientists, we can do the same thing as a technology. We can program this protein with multiple different guide RNAs in the same experiment, in the same cell, and have multiple places in the genome where we introduce precise changes. So it's a very powerful way to do a lot of experimentation at the genetic level in a single experiment. And as I mentioned, it's evolved for rapid and accurate DNA target recognition. And I would just like to share with you a few recent sets of data that we've obtained in the lab that help us understand how this actually works. So one of the things that emerged early on, so this is a cartoon that illustrates work that we did collaboratively with Eva Nogales, a professor here at UC Berkeley who is a specialist in cryo-electron microscopy. We worked with her laboratory, two graduate students, David Taylor and Sam Sternberg, who teamed up to look at the Cas9 protein structure as it goes from protein alone to assembling with nucleic acids. And what those experiments revealed, even at about 30 angstrom resolution, so not very high resolution, we could see that this protein, when it's in the protein alone state, it starts off in a closed conformation in which the two sort of structural parts of the protein are close together. As soon as it assembles with guide RNA, those protein lobes rearrange to open up a channel in the center of the protein, which is where the DNA ends up once this complex assembles with a substrate or a target DNA molecule. So we already got the sense, even at this sort of low-resolution experiment, that there was something very interesting going on with the way this protein rearranged as it assembled with nucleic acid. And now I want to show you a movie that, and hold on just a second, I want to show you a movie that is going to illustrate The conformational changes now using a series of crystallographic structures available for Cas9. So we have much higher resolution snapshots of this protein in different states. And if we morph these together, you can actually see that this protein undergoes a remarkable structural change as it assembles with nucleic acid. So please start the movie. So this starts off with the protein in the closed state. As it morphs to the structure bound to RNA, you saw a big rearrangement in this part of the protein here to accommodate the RNA. And here's the central channel where this guide strand of the RNA ends up. And that's actually where the RNA-DNA hybrid will form once a substrate binds. Now, when the DNA substrate binds, there's an additional conformational change in the protein to accommodate that RNA-DNA hybrid here in the center of the protein. And importantly, this domain right here in yellow is one of the catalytic cleavers. This is one of the domains that actually cuts the DNA. And we found that in all of the available crystal structure, this domain is in the wrong place. It's over here. It's in the wrong place to actually cut the DNA. It's about 30 angstroms away from where it needs to be. And so what you just saw was our imagined sort of modeling of how this domain would have to swing into place to actually be a functional cleaver and to be able to cut the DNA. And so what's emerged in our recent experiments in a paper that was just very recently published last week, we were able to show using fluorescent dyes on this protein that we can actually detect this series of conformational changes by following changes in fluorescence as these dyes move into different positions during this series of conformational changes. And what we learned from that is that we eventually do detect, of course, this active state of the protein. And we think that that active state only occurs when this protein is docked on a DNA molecule that has a perfect match, or at least a very close to perfect match, to the guide RNA. So it really has a way of ensuring that it only cuts DNA that is matched to the guide RNA. Otherwise, it sometimes can bind to DNAs that are off targets, that don't have a perfect match to the guide. But because the cleaver is not in the right place, the DNA does not get cut. Okay. All right, so the other thing that we're doing, so you know, these experiments that I've showed you are all in vitro. That means we're working with purified proteins, nucleic acids, and doing experiments to try to figure out mechanism. Of course, we would really like to figure out how does this actually operate inside of a cell. And if you think about it, it's a really interesting challenge because this is a protein that has evolved over time in bacteria. And so it has to deal with bacterial genomes, which are a lot smaller than eukaryotic genomes like the human genome, and also don't have the kind of highly compacted structures that we see in chromatin in eukaryotic cells. And so how does a bacterial enzyme deal with that? And so this is just a picture of the a nucleosome in the eukaryotic nucleus. And here's the cartoon of the Cas9 protein and what it actually has to do on the DNA. So how does it do this when it's got to deal with DNA that's wrapped up like this? And so we're sort of the questions we're sort of thinking about is how does it deal not only with chromatin structure, but also the larger size of mammalian genomes, as well as the sort of overall organization of DNA in the nucleus. And so to start to answer those questions, Spencer Knight, a graduate student here who is jointly in my lab and the lab of Robert Tijan, has been working on a system to detect and visualize Cas9 complexes as they search through the DNA of a eukaryotic cell, of a mammalian cell. And so I want to just show you a little bit of his data. So basically what we can do is we can fluorescently label Cas9 proteins that are inside living cells. So we're visualizing live cell nuclei, and we're watching particles of the Cas9 protein moving around the nucleus. And when we program Cas9 with what Spencer calls a nonsense guide, a guide RNA that shouldn't recognize any particular sequence in that genome, we see very rapid movement of those particles. And we can plot this, and we have the log of the diffusion coefficient here and the number of particles over here. And you can see that most of these particles are moving very, very rapidly around the cell with respect, and certainly a lot faster than a protein that is part of the chromatin structure called H2B that has much, much slower kinetics in the cell. But we see a very interesting change when we program Cas9 with a guide RNA that recognizes about 300,000 sites in the nucleus. So this is a highly repetitive element in the mammalian genome. And now we find that a lot of these particles are moving much more slowly in the cell. You can really see that visually here. And if we plot these, we see almost a sort of two different populations of molecules, some that are still moving with very fast kinetics, but a large number now that are moving very, very slowly. And we think these correspond to particles that have actually parked themselves on a complementary sequence in the genome, and they hold on. They don't let go. And we're actually, in these experiments, we're using a catalytically inactive form of the protein, so we're not actually cutting the DNA. And so through doing this kind of experiment, we've been able to do things like measure the kinetics of target search in the cell. And we're working right now to try to measure how long it actually takes a single particle of Cas9 to find a single target site in the human genome and really understand how many molecules do we really have to have in the genome to get efficient editing. And this should help us also to avoid off-target effects. So finally, I just want to mention what I think, going forward, what some of the challenges are going to be to using this technology. And I think one of the big ones is how do we deliver this? The other big one, I think, is how we control the way that the DNA is repaired in cells after the cut is made. But certainly, we have to be able to deliver it in the first place, get it into tissues, and wouldn't it be lovely if we could get it into tissues in a specific fashion so that only the tissue where you want therapeutic editing to occur will happen. And so we've been thinking about doing this, again, from the perspective of biochemists. We like the idea of using a pre-assembled protein RNA complex for delivery. And we call these RNPs. This stands for RNA ribonucleoprotein or RNA protein complex. And the idea is simply to take purified Cas9 protein, assemble it with one or more guide RNAs that will direct it to sites where we want to induce editing, and then deliver it into cells. And there are different ways to do that. We're currently doing it with a chemical strategy. And we find that when we do this with cells in the cultured in the lab, we can actually detect editing within a few hours, just a couple of hours. Sort of amazing to think about that in this protein is able to search through the human genome, make a cut, and the cut will be repaired in a way that we can detect within just a couple of hours. Secondly, we know that the half-life of the ribonucleoprotein complex is about 24 hours, and that, we think, will really minimize off-target effects. And finally, and this is the work of both Brett Stahl and Stephen Lin in the laboratory, who have been really developing this methodology, the idea was to take this approach and use it to co-deliver DNA templates for repair. And the idea there is to help control the repair pathway by having the template for repair be present with the tool that's doing the cutting. And Steve and Brett have seen really nice results using this kind of strategy. And we've also been working closely with Alex Marson and Jennifer Puck, who are immunologists at UC San Francisco, to use this for editing primary human T cells. And in partnership with their labs, we've been able to show that we can actually edit human T cells not only to make knockouts of genes, but actually to make knock-ins using this kind of strategy. So there's a lot of excitement about this because, of course, this now opens the door to being able to edit these immune cells in a targeted and precise fashion for doing things like cancer immunotherapy and, of course, for lots of research purposes as well. And Jacob Korn, I want to mention as well, has been a part of this project as part of the innovative genomics initiative that we have going as a partnership between Berkeley and UCSF. So I just want to close by posing this question. So what should we do now that genomes can be edited relatively easily? And I started really thinking about this a lot, you know, in the first few months after this technology was out and being utilized by more and more laboratories, and realizing that, you know, there was the potential to do a lot of very exciting things with this, but also some things that maybe we should be thinking about in a more cautionary fashion. And I realized that the science was moving at 1,000 miles an hour with papers coming out, you know, daily and accelerating, as I showed you. And meanwhile, most non-scientists were really unaware of what we were all doing in our labs. And so I decided to really get out in front of that conversation. And so with the Innovative Genomics Initiative and Jonathan Weissman, who's part of it here, we decided to convene a meeting in the early part of 2015 with a few scientists from around California and a few from elsewhere in Boston to come out and discuss this question. And the upshot of that meeting was to publish what we called a prudent path forward for genome engineering that particularly focused on editing the human germline. That means making changes, precise changes to human embryos or eggs or sperm in such a way that those changes could be passed on to future generations. And this has led to a call for a global conversation about this in the scientific and broader communities. And next month in December, there will be the first international summit in Washington, sponsored by the Chinese Academy of Sciences, the National Academy of Science in the US, and the Royal Society in the UK, with lots of participation from scientists around the world and others who are interested to come and discuss this very issue and how we should proceed in a safe and appropriate fashion. So stay tuned for that. And I'd like to close by thanking my labs. This is a really great group of people. I tried to mention all of those that were involved in this research along the way. I see some of them in the audience. It's great. And of course, I want to give a real shout out to our wonderful collaborators, including the folks at UCSF. This has really been a great opportunity for a basic researcher like me to take a technology that grew out of our homegrown lab efforts and see it really evolving into something that I think is going to be really impactful in the clinic. And then, of course, we couldn't do any of this without funding. We're extremely grateful to all of these groups, and in particular to the National Science Foundation, who gave me a very small grant to support one student that allowed us to get going on this project before anybody knew it would turn into this kind of a technology. So thank you very much.
We have time for some questions.
I see one in the back over there.
Hello. Hi, with the last paper that you'd referenced about the social implications of this technology, are you kind of alluding to the idea of editing genomes of human embryos or, you know, the existing cells that would that are in storage right now? Or like what exactly kind of are the consequences of this?
Right. Well, so I think just to be clear, there's important to make the distinction between editing cells in an adult. Right, somatic cell editing, which means that we could make changes in, say, a tissue that would have a therapeutic benefit, but not in a way that those changes would be passed on to children. Right, whereas germline editing refers to making changes such that the eggs and sperm of the person that would develop from that edited embryo would contain those changes, so they'd be passed on to future generations. And we're really proposing that latter type of editing is something that really raises ethical and societal questions and needs to be thoroughly considered before proceeding.
Jennifer, maybe I can ask. Okay. One of the big challenges is to make sure that you don't have off-target effects. Does the structural analysis explain to you how even a single base mismatch could prevent the cleaving, for example, or prevent the function?
Yeah, I think one thing that's very interesting is that this series of conformational changes that happen in the protein are really happening as a function of cognate base pairing between the target DNA and the guide RNA, such that we even see that when there's a mismatch in the RNA-DNA hybrid that occurs there's sort of one end of that duplex that's a little more tolerant to mismatches than the other. But even at that more tolerant end, we see that there's an effect on the ability of that conformational change to put the cleavage domain in the right place to cut the DNA. And we know this from our fluorescence-based studies. So I think the answer is yes, and I'm really interested to see if we can now take that mechanistic understanding and use it to help either design or evolve proteins that maybe have even better accuracy.
I see one. Question over here and over there.
A couple.
I guess. Well, anyway, I'll talk loudly. Your picture looked like the Cas9 was popping on and off of the DNA rather than sliding along it. Was that just because there was such a small plane of focus, or do you think it pops on and off?
That's what we think. Both our in vitro and our cell-based data are consistent with a diffusion model. So it's basically, you know, diffusing rapidly around the cell. It's binding and releasing the DNA very quickly rather than sliding processively along the DNA. Yeah.
Maybe one more question.
Yeah, I had a question related to the off-target. So you mentioned that some of the specificity comes from that rotation of the cleavage domain. And so do you think that all of the technologies that use a dead Cas9, or like a Cas9 that doesn't cleave, might actually have different off-targets than the sort of like traditional double-strand break?
Right now, I would say no. And the reason is that these deactivated forms of Cas9 that people are working with are point mutations in the active site. Okay, so like a single amino acid change. So that's a big domain that has to swing into place. And we think we've not really tested these D. Let's see, I'm trying to think if we have done the FRET. I think the FRET experiments have not been done with the deactivated form of the protein for the most part, but we have no reason to think that that domain motion in the protein wouldn't happen even when you have a point mutation in the DNA, in the protein. But that might be something that would be interesting to look at, actually. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, our next speaker is Napoleone Ferrara, and the title is Targeting VEGF for Age-Related Macular Degeneration, a Case Study for Reduction in the Incidence of Blindness.
Well, thank you very much. I think it's an honor to be a participant to this symposium, actually. tough fact, you know, to follow up on this very inspiring, you know, molecular and technological talks. My work is very biologically, I would say, disease-oriented, medical-oriented. I've been studying now for almost, you know, three decades, you know, what I believe is to be an important, you know, biological process, which is a vascularization, the development of blood vessels. I think it's very intuitive that your blood vessels are very important in physiology, it's very difficult to have any growth, anything meaningful in a multicellular organism unless you have your blood supply with the delivery of nutrients and oxygen. So the blood vessels are known to be important for millennia. What has been a little bit more recently appreciated, you know, the blood vessels can play a role in some diseases, some very important role, actually. One of the diseases which was probably first associated, you know, with excessive blood vessel growth or angiogenesis, cancer, actually. I'm not going to talk much about that today. At about the same time, actually, the first, you know, studies on cancer were done in the late 30s. You know. In the late 40s, you know, came this very, really important, very influential paper by an ophthalmologist, Isaac Michelson. At the time, he was working in Glasgow, and then he moved into Israel, you know, to continue his work, you know. And largely based on very extremely insightful clinical and pathological observation, actually looking at the diabetic retinopathy, he concluded, you know, that the disease retina, the ischemic retina, must be producing some compound, some blood vessel growth, you know, stimulating factor, which later on actually was called factor X, you know. For example, you observe that even though there is a disease in the retina, you can have a growth of blood vessels in the iris, which is in the front of eyes. So it would imply that this molecule can be actually secreted by the retina, go across, you know, the vitreous, and then reaches, you know, the iris. It gives rise to this condition, actually, which is known as rubiosis of iris. And so there has been, for many decades, this search, you know, for this, you know, hypothetical molecule, because let's be clear, this is very purely hypothetical molecule that, you know, that in cancer or in development or in dye could induce angiogenesis. And actually, largely because of the work done by Judah Folkman starting in the early 70s, there was lots of interest in identifying this molecule. And actually, in the mid-90s, when I started, you know, becoming interested in this field, there was already quite a bit of a body of work. You know, there was as many as, you know, a dozen of angiogenic factors which have been identified, actually, mostly proteins, but not all proteins, you know. And probably the most prominent of those was basic FGF, fibroblast growth factor, which is a molecule which is well known, for example, to neurobiologists, which is a very pleiotropic molecule, a molecule that can do just about anything, And it is a very potent angiogenic factor. Something very, very puzzling emerged, in the mid-80s when the FGF was cloning. It does not have a signal peptide, so it's not a secreting protein. And so you can immediately appreciate, just looking at this slide, actually, that the angiogenesis almost, intuitively required the release of some molecule in the microenvironment because it needs to be created some kind of gradient, some kind of biochemical gradient which attract, blood vessels. So in other words, a molecule like FGF, even though it was pharmacologically very potent, but it didn't seem to be really so well suited, to regulate angiogenesis. Even experiment with antibody, even later on knockout, it didn't show that an FGF all these other molecules were important. And actually, in the 80s, actually, when I started my work, I was a postdoc, actually, across the bay at UCSF, actually, was working in a completely different field, actually. I was working on endocrinology, on the pituitary, actually. Part of my postdoctoral project was I was able to isolate and characterize some cells known as folliculostellate cells, which are rather obscure cells in the pituitary, which is always seems to where already not, to have some unique kind of, interaction with blood vessels. They ended up in close proximity with the blood vessels in the pituitary. So suggesting some kind of role in regulating this process. And actually, in the course of the years, actually, I observed that the cells release inactivity. Just at that time, in the 80s, there was all these factors uncharacterized, etc. I thought it was very, very intriguing. Over the years, I was able to isolate, to purify the protein. Those were the days where to go to the DNA, you have first, to purify the protein, sequence, and then based on the amino acid sequence, design probe, for cDNA cloning. And in 1989, actually, I joined Genentech at that time. We were able, actually, to clone, this molecule, which we call vascular endothelial growth factor. And at that time, we didn't know whether it was an important molecule. But, certainly with some interesting features, For example, it's a secreting molecule, which is kind of emphasized in this paper, unlike, this other molecule. So potentially could be released into the microenvironment and play a role. But that's all we knew at the time, and we didn't know whether this was going to be one more angiogenic factor. And actually, it took several years, but this is one of probably the most, still I believe, one of the most, compelling experiments which indicate, the VEGF was an important molecule. This is the VEGF, knockout in mice, actually. And you can see this is the yolk sac of the wild type. You see this very nice, this beautiful vascular supply in the yolk sac. And this is the VEGF, mutant, which lacks only one of the two alleles. So there is still 50% of VEGF. And as you can see, there is hardly any blood islands in the yolk sac, and the embryo is already severely underdeveloped. It's probably already dead, So this is seems to be an important molecule. Seems to be one of the very, very few examples, at least in the mammalian genome, of this kind of, critical dependence on a factor for the vascularization, actually, this haploid insufficiency, And since then, I think we learned a lot about this molecule, and now, actually, it's a very well-established, very well-characterized, system. Actually, there is, some receptor, some tyrosine kinase, receptor. One is the best known is VEGF, receptor 2, as well as some co-receptor like a neuropilin, which is also, a molecule implicated, in neurobiology. So the activation by VEGF, this tyrosine kinase receptor result in a signaling cascade, which is not that different from other tyrosine kinase, like the PDGF, receptor. And now we understand, VEGF is important in a variety of physiological processes, and even in the adult. It became a therapeutic target, actually. I'm not going to show this data, but in the interest of time. Already it became known that it blocked, VEGF, either the ligand or the cyclic cascade can inhibit, tumor growth. And that result, actually, in the therapeutic application, therapeutic intervention, there is today as many as 12, different, VEGF, pathway inhibitor, which has been approved in therapy. You know, it's been approved in cancer therapy, for example, in colon cancer, in renal cell cancer, as well as in a variety of malignancies. You know, but admittedly, I think the most interesting, perhaps the most impactful application is not in cancer, but actually is in dye. You know. Cancer is such a clever, system, find a way, almost a diabolic way, always to evade, develop, resistance. Seems to be that this problem was less in dye. Let me first, point out, actually, this slice derived from cancer, but applies virtually any system, VEGF is induced by hypoxia, by now well-known and well-characterized mechanism. There is a transcription factor called IF1R, as well as others, actually, which result in upregulation of a series of hypoxia inducible genes, including VEGF. And so this is really is very important physiologically, because whenever you have hypoxia, you need more blood vessels. A molecule like VEGF is released and actually creating new blood vessels. And so the question is VEGF is this hypothetical factor X at least related to this hypothetical factor X hypothesis postulated by Michelson in the 40s. Actually, once again, there's some interesting characteristic, like it's a diffusible molecule. Also, very importantly, it can be induced by hypoxia, because hypoxia and vascular damage are kind of key features of this disease in dye. And actually, just to illustrate you how the eye at the retina in a patient with a diabetic retinopathy, which is one of the key ischemic retinal disease, looks like. You don't need to be an ophthalmologist to appreciate this very extensive vascular disorganization of these vessels, which are really so abnormal, tortuous, and there is extensive bleeding, which can result in blindness, and actually this illustrates some of the characteristic of these vessels. Actually, they lack some key elements in the vessel wall, which are called pericytes, and the loss of this pericyte result in this very abnormal vascular bed, which is very leaky, a tendency to bleed, and so this result in this actually in some of these key events, And actually, almost over 20 years ago, actually, using at the time some very sensitive assay, which was developed in our lab, in collaboration with a group at Harvard, with George King, and colleagues, were able to show that the levels of VEGF are elevated in dye fluid of patients with ischemic retinal disease, like the diabetic retinopathy, retinopathy of prematurity, and also occlusion of a retinal vein, which is another disease resulting in ischemia. There was almost a perfect correlation between the levels of VEGF in the eye fluid, and actually, angiogenesis. And this is actually an animal experiment, which at the time actually was a very seems to be very compelling. This is a primate model of a laser induced occlusion of the retinal veins, which create this ischemia and release VEGF. And this is actually this intensive angiogenesis in the iris, just like I was at the very beginning alluding to Michelson, idea. And as you can see, an antibody to VEGF almost completely actually inhibit this process. At the time, the animal data were very compelling, but there was a lot of skepticism that this could have really any clinical relevance, because many people, it was not, that this event, happened in this animal model within 2 or 3 weeks, and that the blood vessels regress. Instead, in the humans, this disease, takes place in years, sometimes even in decades. So this was a really little bit, slow down, the process, the decision to develop, a VEGF inhibitor. But there was actually another disease which was has been historical and a met, medical need, which is age-related macular degeneration, which is the leading cause of blindness in the population over 50. This is some of the features of this disease, actually. To make a long story short, the disease has been historically classified in two types, the dry form and the wet form. The dry form is characterized by this, actually, by this structure. Actually, let me go by order. The dry form is characterized by the so-called, drusen, which has a series of bumps, in the retina. And unless they have become too many, they don't really impair vision. Instead, the neovascular form, the wet, form, even though accounts for only maybe 20% of the case of AMD is the one which is responsible for about 80% of the case of blindness, you know. And so this is clearly is an enormous unmet, you know, medical need. A work done over the last, you know, 10 years has showed that there is some very clearly, you know, genetic, you know, factor, some genes mutated which predispose to AMD. And there is some which are more important than others, actually. But the one which is very clearly has been the most important, the most, you know, strongly associated, you know, with AMD is a complement factor H, which is a protein we actually regulate, you know, complement, inhibits, you know, is like a dampening system for complement, you know. So whenever you have this mutation, you know, in complement factor H, there is an excessive inactivation of a complement, which normally is role actually to help us to fight, you know, pathogens, you know. But anyway, if not you know, properly inhibited and regulated, you know, can give rise to tissue damage and inflammation. And this is what is believed to happen in AMD, actually. And actually, this mutation in complement factor H seems to be actually a risk, you know, factor for both, you know, the dry and the wet, you know, form. This is our patients with a different kind of this disease, you know, actually, as opposed to see. This is a patient with a diabetic retinopathy. Even though there is a large areas where there is actually in the peripheral retina where there is this black, you know, spot in the peripheral retina, but the central vision, which is very critical for reading, for writing, etc., is relatively preserved. You know, instead in a patient with AMD, at least with the severe AMD, even though the peripheral retina, the peripheral vision is relatively spared, you can see this is really actually the central vision, which is the one which is so severely impaired. So even individuals which otherwise could be relatively healthy are unable to read, you know, to write. So the quality of life is really very severely actually deteriorated. And so this is actually, as I was alluding at the beginning, when it was initially believed that there is a dry and a wet, you know, form. Now it's very clear that this kind of, you know, is a spectrum of, you know, of AMD, actually. Area of, you know, dry and wet, you know, can coexist in the same eye. And actually, this is the way, actually, the advanced, you know, AMD with associated with the dry AMD looks like. You have this area of a geographic atrophy. This is pretty broad areas, you know, actually, with a depigmentation, which kind of expand, you know, and eventually deteriorate, you know, vision very, very significantly. And this is really what is, once again, the most, you know, destructive form, which is the neovascular form, you know, actually. You know, this growth of vessels which come from, you know, the choroid, which is an extravascular bed, you know. And they literally make the holes across, you know, membrane, which is called, you know, Bruch, you know, membrane. And this vessel can be very catastrophic because they can bleed and they leak, you know, it can destroy the photoreceptors. And so at the time, you know, in the mid-90s, actually, when all this work, you know, was actually the story of VEGF, you know, kind of, you know, was developing, actually, there was lots of debate as to what kind of disease you may want, you know, to target. You know, there is a much more compelling scientific rationale to target, like, the diabetic retinopathy or the ischemic retinal disease because, you know, VEGF was so clearly associated with this disease. But at the time, on the other hand, there was some pretty effective, you know, therapy for this form, which is less photocoagulation. And instead, there was really nothing for age-related macular degeneration, actually. But, you know, admittedly, the evidence of VEGF was implicated was very weak. You know, there was only some immunohistochemical data showed that there is a VEGF expressed, you know, in this choroidal neovascular membrane. But on the other hand, there was such an important disease, such an unmet, you know, medical need that, you know, it was decided, actually, to develop a clinical trial, actually. And actually, difficult was what kind of molecule are you going to use, you know, to do this, you know, injection in the eye. No one has done any long-term administration of an antibody in the eye because it was believed would be much safer to inject, you know, locally. So it was thought, you know, an antibody fragment, which is an FAB, which is a monovalent antibody, which is devoid of FC, could be the safer form. And actually, this is actually the clinical data actually was presenting, or was first shown some time ago, actually, at the time. This is a visual acuity of patients with an aggressive type of AMD, which is a classical form, which is extensive neovascularization. And patients actually were randomized, to receive, either this an anti-VEGF antibody, which is called ranibizumab, which is was injected, intravitreally every month, And actually, the green line is not a placebo, is what at that time was the standard of therapy, which is the photodynamic therapy. And as you can see, there is a little bit of increase, in visual acuity with the photodynamic therapy, and then there is a kind of unstoppable vision loss, And instead, with each one of these two doses of ranibizumab, but there was a very striking, at that time, this was a totally unexpected, there is an increase in visual acuity. It was possible to show that about 35 to 40% of patients have this marked increase in visual acuity. In about 90%, you prevent, severe visual loss. So this was all very unexpected. It is actually some of the concept, vascular biology actually show that, by blocking VEGF, we almost completely inhibit, further growth of this choroidal neovascular membrane. But the vessels are substantially remodel, and so this probably show why they leak less. But so the question is, what is the real impact, on blindness? Actually, the clinical data, the clinical trial data look very striking. There is this model, done, by a group at Johns Hopkins, by Bressel et al, that, predict, that if patients were treated, like in clinical trial, there was with the VEGF inhibitor, there would be a very substantial reduction in legal blindness, But then in the real world, data in the clinical trial data could be something very different, Usually, actually, the clinical trial, it's very difficult to fully replicate, in the real world, the clinical data, because a patient don't follow very regularly. But, this is a very, very important study. It was published in Denmark, a study done in Denmark a few years ago. And look at the incidence of legal blindness, either due to macular degeneration of this line, in black, versus other forms of blindness, non-related, to AMD. And actually show that actually after the availability of VEGF inhibitor in 2006, there has been a steady, drop, in the incidence of legal blindness. Actually, there is about, 50% actually drop, So a similar data has been seen in other countries. So I believe this is probably the most, striking result of, the angiogenesis field. I believe very, very significant. And I'd like to, I know that I'm running over time. I'd like to make a point that actually there is a other approach. We have not really totally solved, the problem, because there is maybe 25 to 30% of patients which are not, effectively treated, by VEGF inhibitor. And there is a geographic atrophy, which of course, is not a neovascular stage. Actually, it could be where there is a clearly an unmet, medical need, And I was alluding at the beginning that complement seems to play a very important role in that. You know, there is a number of strategies targeting the complement, And actually, even though there is no drug which has been approved, but there is some very preliminary data suggesting, that if you inhibit, complement, in particular with antibody to factor D, you can at least, reduce, the growth of this, of the geographic atrophy. And as such, since I went over time, I will say that, this has been actually very exciting to see this start, from a basic research to some clinical data, but there is much more to be done. And certainly, I've been very fortunate to have some incredible colleagues that over decades have been actually given a major contribution. Thank you very much for your attention.
A couple of questions. Maybe I'll just start. So now that Jennifer can knock out your VEGF receptor, what do you think of that? Or would you not risk lowering signaling by VEGF to zero?
Well, I think this is a case where actually the classical genetics, even the very powerful manipulation, were not terribly helpful. For example, I would like to say that you can never predict, you know, that VEGF could be important, you know, even measuring a panel of cytokines, et cetera, in the eye fluid, et cetera. But, you know, in terms of a knockout receptor, I don't think I would be very careful in doing that, because there is some evidence that actually even the knockout already was very illuminating. There is like a gene dose, apple insufficiency, you know. If you inhibit, you know, the VEGF system very hard, you may actually promote, you know, geographic atrophy. So you don't, you actually, these days, people started backing off from this kind of monthly injection of, you know, VEGF inhibitor. You have a PRN kind of, as needed, you know, kind of treatment. In general, you know, four to five injections per year is what you need, actually, to do that, which is obviously very, very fortunate.
Okay, well, okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. So our final talk of the session is Robert Weinberg, The Engine Driving Malignant Progression.
Thank you, and thanks for the invitation to be here. I'll be talking about something very different now, and that is to say the disease of cancer. I'm one of a large cohort of cancer researchers of whom one says more people are dying, are living off the disease than dying from it. There are many of us. Just to begin, I would just mention the fact that if you look at a whole variety of different kinds of cancers, cancers develop in a multi-step process that often takes many decades long to develop to its completion. Already in 1989, Fogelstein and Kinsler and others were able to show that in the context of colorectal cancer, these changes in the histopathology of a tumor leading from fully normal tissue to a primary carcinoma involved and are accompanied by alterations in the genetic constitution of the cells that are evolving progressively more to a state of high-grade malignancy. The same can be said, for example, in the pancreas, where once again, as one sees the increasing degree of histopathological abnormality, one sees the accumulation of genetic mutations which are not simply accompanying this change, but actually driving the change. And the model that has developed is that there's a whole series of pathways in a human cell that need to be deregulated. Here is one representation of this, and what one has learned is if one perturbs each of these distinct signaling pathways together, that will create a fully transformed cell, indicating that one needs multiple successive changes in a human cell, at this case in the level of genetics, in order to create a fully neoplastic, a fully malignant, a transformed cell. This has led in turn to a model of Darwinian evolution, where one has mutation followed by selectively advantageous mutations, followed by clonal expansion, which leads to new populations of cells that sustain a second and a third and a fourth mutation, each of which confers increased proliferative advantage, and that in turn allows the clonal expansion that leads to these highly malignant cells. Once again, a series of four, five, six, seven changes. And these changes, this complexity of multi-step tumorigenesis, explains much of the overall phenomenology of human cancer, because here one sees that most cancers take a very long time to develop, with the exception, interestingly, of female breast cancer. But luckily, most of the defenses that are hardwired into our cells are able to act to forestall the appearance of human cancer simply because they are so complex and require multiple steps of being breached by these multiple mutations, which I indicate are accumulated in human cells as they progress ever more closely to high-grade malignancy. So given all this, the formation going from here to a primary tumor, which we would call this carcinoma, the question is what goes on at the last stage? And does that last change, going from a primary tumor to a distant metastasis, actually require additional genetic mutations? And is it also a process driven by some kind of Darwinian evolution? In truth, this process going from a primary cancer to metastasis is actually, it subsumes a much more complex multi-step process that's often called the invasion metastasis cascade and involves the acquisition of invasiveness by cancer cells, their invasion into and escape from the circulation, and ultimately the formation of a macroscopic metastasis. And the question is then, is this last step also fueled and driven by additional genetic mutations? And here one learns, at least in the case of carcinomas, which on their own constitute roughly 80% of human cancers. Some interesting lessons from looking at tumors like this one here. Here we see a human breast cancer cells, which are expressing, interestingly, an epithelial marker. By definition, carcinomas all derive from epithelial tissues, and this indicates that these carcinoma cells express an epithelial marker, seen here in red. Outside of these implanted carcinoma cells are host cells, indicated by their blue nuclei, which are normal host cells that are recruited into the tumor by the cancer cells in order to provide the tumor cells with various kinds of physiologic support. And of great interest to our discussion today are these green cells, because they have shut down the epithelial marker, in this case it's called cytokeratin, and instead now express a mesenchymal marker, vimentin. And this means that these cells have undergone a profound transdifferentiation, a change in cell state. Previously they were epithelial cells, such as those that line our skin, and now they've become connective tissue cells, and this change, which occurs massively in this tumor, seems to generate an entirely new set of cell biological attributes. So here one imagines this conversion occurs on all of the fronts of the cancer cell, and thereby engenders these profound changes in cell phenotype. Here one can see it more closely, where we see a tongue of carcinoma cells expressing the epithelial marker once again. Outside are the recruited host cells. We call these the stromal cells. And what you see is that the carcinoma cells that are directly opposed to the stroma seem to have undergone this change from an epithelial to mesenchymal state. And this change is often called the epithelial mesenchymal transition. And it's a cell biological program that is involved often in wound healing, as I'll show momentarily in embryogenesis. And it dows these cells, obviously being triggered by contextual signals with a whole new set of properties. Here one sees the converse process, a tongue of carcinoma cells that have instead of now express the mesenchymal marker vimentin, which the cells in the center of this tongue of carcinoma cells did not express. And this cell biological program was described first in 1986 by Betty Hay, who was a chairman of cell biology at Harvard Medical School, or as they call themselves, the medical school in Boston, much to the distress of the other medical schools in Boston. But we won't go there. And here we see it's a series of cell biological changes which involve more than just subtle changes in cell biological phenotype. It's a profound shift in cell biology. When my lab first started working on this epithelial mesenchymal transition, I got pushback from the developmental biologists who said, being very territorial, this is really their domain. Why am I horning in on what they're working on? And I realized only years later that I have a legal and hereditary right to work on the EMT, because it turns out Elizabeth Hay was lured into the profession of biology when she was an undergraduate by my sister-in-law's father. So obviously preordained. Anyhow, so one thing that's unexplained by what I've told you until now is the nature of the signals that are released by the stroma and impinge on the carcinoma cells to evoke the activation of this previously latent EMT program, which is normally unexpressed in the epithelial cells, but is expressed, is induced in response to these signals. Here we see one manifestation of this, the work of Ann Lee. Here's a carcinoma cell, releases this signaling molecule, it's called interleukin-1, that impinges on a stromal cell, a normal recruited host cell that responds in a multitude of ways, sending signals reciprocally back to the carcinoma cell, which then activates its previously latent EMT program, which previously had not been expressed. Here's another alternative interaction between the stromal cells and the carcinoma cell. In this case, we're talking about a carcinoma cell that has already activated its EMT program, already has acquired mesenchymal characteristics, and here it recruits a host cell, a macrophage, which becomes tethered mechanically to the carcinoma cell, sends signals in that sustain the expression of the EMT program long after it's been activated, ensuring that this carcinoma cell will dwell for a longer period of time in the mesenchymal state. The EMT program is of ancient lineage. Here we see a sea urchin embryo in which a blast gel is already activating the EMT program in anticipation of forming the endoderm and the mesoderm. And in fact, there are a series... Well, Gary has connections with the fire department. That's nothing. So we don't talk about that. What are you going to do next? So here we see a whole series of metazoa, and there are a series of transcription factors which are master regulators that orchestrate the EMT program in a whole variety of different species. All of these transcription factors, these master regulators of the EMT program, are present in the genomes of all complex metazoa, indicating they were already evolved 600 million years ago before the metazoan radiation and have been highly conserved in the intervening 600 million years. Here I'm shifting gears momentarily to indicate the work of Michael Clark and Muhammad Al-Haj, who were interested in the biology of breast cancer cells. And here they took a human breast cancer and they fractionated individual cells in the breast cancer into two classes using fluorescence-activated cell sorting. Here was a minority of cells, and as few as 200 of these, when implanted in a mouse, already was sufficient to trigger the outgrowth of a new tumor. Conversely, here was a majority of population of cells, and these cells lacked this tumor-initiating capability. So these cells could reside in at least two alternative phenotypic states, the same as cells could reside alternatively in an epithelial and mesenchymal state. And what one came to mind was a hierarchical model like this, which had been previously embraced by those studying normal epithelial physiology, in which at the apex here, one has a self-renewing stem cell that is able to divide and generate copies of itself, but generate a majority population which lacks this stem-like quality. And given that, this was used and invoked to see how cancer cells would behave in similar fashion. And here we see a fax analysis, majority population of non-stem cells, minority population of stem cells in a slightly different fax analysis. And what Sender Raimani and Maijing Liao did in my laboratory was to ask the following question. Is there any connection between the EMT program I told you before about and the stem cell program, which I've just described? And what they found was when they took these non-stem cells and they forced them to go through an EMT, changing their morphology and monolayer culture, all of the non-stem cells migrated en masse from the non-stem cell into the stem cell position, providing the initial indication that the EMT program is a very important route by which epithelial cells can enter into the stem cell state. Indeed, naturally present epithelial stem cells express a whole series of mesenchymal markers, indicative of the notion that, in fact, the EMT program is an important route for cancer cells and normal epithelial cells to enter into the stem cell state. Implicit in what I'm saying are actually two things. First of all, there's great similarity in these processes between normal and neoplastic stem cells. And secondly, the changes I'm describing here, to the extent that they're important in the biology of normal cells and cancer cells, have nothing to do with the genome, because these are all epigenetic changes. And to the extent that one wants to understand the biology of cancer cells, sequencing the genomes of human cancer cells, which is all the rage these days, will tell one absolutely nothing. So, but this stays entre nous here. Okay, so Maijing, Wenjun Guo asked the question, can one produce more compelling experimental proofs that there's a connection between the EMT program and the stem cell program? What he did was he took mammary stromal fat pads, removed the rudimentary epithelial cells there, implanted mammary epithelial cells, and if they indeed contain mammary epithelial stem cells, they could generate a new incomplete mammary ductal tree, a stringent test of the stemness of the implanted cells. And what he found, to make a long story short, was that if one takes epithelial mammary epithelial cells, a certain quantum of them, and puts them into a mammary stromal fat pad and waits 6 or 8 weeks, they form a rudimentary structure like this. However, if one takes those cells, briefly exposes them to an EMT-inducing signal, and then implants them, they form mammary ductal trees like this, improving by a factor of 25 their ability to seed an entire adult organ, indicating very strongly the connection between the EMT program and the epithelial stem cell program. Here he increased the stemness of these cells by a factor of 100 by exposing them transiently to EMT-inducing transcription factors and plotting out a very simple genetic path between bona fide stem cells and highly differentiated cells. This led in turn to another series of questions, but perhaps for me the most interesting question was the following. I told you before that the formation of a primary tumor involves a whole succession of genetic changes. Is it the case that this final step involves the additional accumulation of genetic changes, or might it be the case that the cells that have arrived at this stage in multi-step tumor genesis are already genetically equipped to metastasize, needing only to activate their previously unexpressed or latent EMT program? And in other words, are these carcinoma cells already genetically equipped to metastasize? And to do that, Zuzana Keshkishova and Yasmin de Kock did a series of experiments. They turned on the EMT transcription factors in an otherwise benign set of tumor cells. The otherwise benign tumor cells 10 weeks later formed smooth boundaries, indicating a lack of invasiveness. The cells that had 10 weeks earlier experienced transiently the expression of EMT-inducing transcription factors were highly invasive. And perhaps most compelling is the metastatic behavior of these cancer cells. The cancer cells that had not experienced transiently 10 weeks earlier the EMT formed very few metastases in the lungs. However, those that 10 weeks earlier had indeed formed lung metastases now formed 400 micrometastases, small clusters of cancer cells in the lung, or alternatively, macroscopic metastases, far larger than these small clusters. And I think given the time, maybe I should... I have still a couple minutes. Oh, you scared me. Okay, so just to finish up, I mean, I'm still in the business, but just for today. Here's the cross-section of a mammary duct, the work of Chinier. And what she has studied is the fact that the mammary duct is a bilayered epithelium. Here's the lumen. Luminal cells on the inside and on the outside are basal cells, which are the known sites of mammary epithelial stem cells. And the question is, if one induces now cancer in these mammary epithelial cells, in this case in the mouse, what will happen in terms of the formation of cancers, the normal stem cells, and the cancer stem cells? Again, to repeat, the normal stem cells are known to reside out here, and these normal cells, stem cells express naturally the slug EMT-inducing transcription factor, indicating that the EMT program has a role in normal stemness. Here you see one manifestation of this in the work of Chinier, bilayered epithelium. Slug is expressed here on the outside. This is the location of the of mammary stem cells. Here's a complication here, because on the outside, you see cells expressing other kinds of EMT-inducing transcription factors, these green cells on the outside, because this mammary duct, like the tumors I showed you earlier, is surrounded by a normal stroma. And the normal stroma is naturally composed of mesenchymal cells, and they actually express a whole series of EMT-inducing transcription factors. Here's yet another EMT-inducing transcription factor expressed by the stromal cells, the normal host tissue, which complicates the analysis. Here, to make a long story short, are the results of Chinier's recent analysis of what happens when one actually induces carcinoma in a breast cancer-prone transgenic mouse. And it's actually quite interesting, at least for us. I mean, maybe not on the canvas of world history, but at least for us, it's interesting. Here we see the bilayered epithelium that normally exists in a normal mammary gland. Slug is naturally expressed. This is an EMT-inducing transcription factor in normal basal cells. Luminal cells express none of these. If one starts the development of cancer, now one sees suddenly the appearance of the first cousin of slug, termed snail, which is turned on and turns on yet another EMT-inducing transcription factor, ZEB1. And I will tell you now that these cells are now cancer stem cells, which means that if they're extracted and implanted in a mouse, they can now generate new tumors. That has an interesting kind of take-home lesson, because it suggests that the cancer stem cells which arise here do not derive from the normal pre-existing normal mammary stem cells, which are in the other cell layer. In other words, cancer stem cells turn on their program rather than drawing from the pre-existing normal stem cell program. These cells up here turn out to be highly metastatic, the sources of lung metastases, and after they disseminate to distant tissues, the cancer stem cells then generate in the metastases a hierarchy which has a vague resemblance to what pre-existed in the normal tissue prior to metastatic dissemination. So we begin to realize now the dynamics of what governs normal epithelial stem cell physiology and how this program can be subverted by the cancer cells by activating, in this case, previously latent EMT-inducing transcription factors to drive their malignant progression. And now my time is definitively off. Unfortunately, unlike Gary, I don't have any close connections with the Berkeley Fire Department, which allowed him to gracefully evade a whole host of screening questions of heckling from a critical audience. Oh, thank you.
So Bob would like some heckling.
Usually when I'm here at Berkeley, I get heckling from Peter Duisberg, but he's actually not here, is he? Sir?
Are some of the environmental cues that trigger EMT mechanical, yes, as well as chemical?
It's not clear. It's clear that a lot of pro-inflammatory signals are responsible, released by inflammatory cells, such as macrophages and myofibroblasts, inactivating the EMT. And those are, let's say, diffusible or paracrine and juxtacrine signals. The additional question is the stiffness of the extracellular matrix of which the stroma is composed, is that also an important clue? And there seem to be indication that that also adds insult to injury. So there are multifactorial environmental or contextual signals that awaken the previously latent EMT program in epithelial cells, and they may indeed contribute to that as well. Indeed, I showed you several examples of these heterotypic signals going from the stroma to the epithelium, and there are likely to be other combinations of such signals that operate during cancer progression and, by the way, also in normal embryogenesis, where the EMT program plays a frequent role in the interconversion of different cell types during organogenesis.
Thank you. We would love to have another question. However, the physicists are going to pull the alarm again. If we do, they're sick of the biologists talking so much. Thank you to all of the speakers.
Thank you.